Hi, and welcome to my Low Carb Health Doctor channel. If you open this video, you probably have heard of the so-called ketogenic diet or the keto diet in short. But you may not be that very familiar with it and what it's supposed to be. Would you like to understand more what the keto diet really is? Well, you've come to the right place. It's good to find you here because in this video, that's what we are precisely going to do. Today, let's dissect what really is the ketogenic diet and what good can it do for you. Many have considered the keto diet is just another fad diet, particularly one that was supposed to promise quick weight loss and lesser body inflammation. Well, I would tend to agree with that. Indeed, it could be just a fad diet for you, especially if you really don't know what it is and what's the real deal, the science behind it. Most probably because you are doing it just for the kicks, perhaps to go with the trend, but to follow what your friends are doing from what they're posting in Facebook and YouTube. However, I'm here to tell you that there's a whole world of science behind it, and you should know what that science is all about so that you can properly decide if the ketogenic diet is good enough for you. First things first. The ketogenic diet is actually part of the spectrum of diets that fall under the low-carbohydrate diet category. Compared to other low-carbohydrate diet regimens, a low-carbohydrate ketogenic diet is considered among the ones containing the lowest consumption of net carbohydrates less than 50 grams per day. A much lower daily carbohydrate allocation of less than 30 grams is expected for the very low-carbohydrate ketogenic diet. With its low to very low carbohydrate content, the ketogenic diet was named as such because of its tendency to making the body go into a state called nutritional ketosis. Different macronutrients elicit different levels of insulin response from the pancreas. Of course, carbohydrates elicit the highest levels of insulin in the blood. Fats have the least insulin response, with proteins somewhere in the middle. So with very low carbohydrate food intake, the insulin level in the body does not rise as much. And with low levels of insulin, the metabolic process of lipolysis is activated, thus leading to the release of fatty acids from the body's fat stores. Excess fatty acids are brought to the liver, where they are catabolized to ketone bodies, specifically acetoacetate, acetone, and 3-beta-hydroxybutyrate. So how did we first come to know about the ketogenic diet? Physicians first used the so-called ketogenic diet for the treatment of epileptic patients in the 1920s. So we neurologists are quite familiar with this. However, prior to this, for over 2,000 years, since at least 500 BC, fasting has already been known as a way of treating different ailments, including epilepsy, as noted in the Hippocratic Corpus. The ketogenic diet was originally meant to imitate the benefits of fasting, particularly the production of ketones in the liver. This was especially embodied in the works of Drs. Galen, Woodyatt, and Wilder in 1921. It was Dr. Russell Wilder who first designated the term ketogenic diet to such dietary intervention. And by 1925, Dr. M.G. Peterman of the Mayo Clinic reported in the Journal of the American Medical Association a ketogenic diet formulation that is much similar to what is being used today, and which was meant for epileptic children, consisting of daily allocations of about 10 to 15 grams carbohydrates, 1 gram per kilogram body weight of protein, and the remainder as fat calories. However, in 1938, in the anti-seizure properties of the drug diphenylhydantoin, more commonly known as phenytoin, was discovered by the neurologists Dr. H. Houston Merritt and Dr. Tracy Putnam. The use of the ketogenic diet among epileptic patients gradually waned and fell by the wayside. Let's talk a little bit of science here. As a very low carbohydrate form of low carbohydrate diets, the ketogenic diet mimics a lot of the biochemical scenarios of fasting. Hence, with the very minimal levels of carbohydrates and the relative abundance of healthy fats, the secretion of the hormone insulin by the beta cells in the pancreas is kept at low levels. One of the basic functions of insulin is the inhibition of hormone-sensitive lipase. This is an enzyme in fat cells that breaks down fats through hydrolysis. This is otherwise known as lipolysis. This results in the release of free fatty acids. Low levels of insulin encourage the body to enter what is called a fat burning mode. This is further enhanced by elevated levels of the hormone glucagon. Fatty acids may be used as a source of energy by certain body tissues, including your skeletal and heart muscles, as well as the liver. However, the brain does not utilize fatty acids for its energy needs, thus it would need ketones. When there is high level of free fatty acids in the blood, and in the background of low levels of insulin, these fatty acids are then brought to the mitochondria of the liver, where they are catabolized or broken down into ketones. Ketones are then used as fuel by the neurons of the brain, as well as cells of the skeletal muscles and the heart. The low levels of glucose are then primarily allocated for the cells which do not consume ketones, such as your red blood cells. Perhaps you may have heard of ketoacidosis, and you might wonder, how is nutritional ketosis different from ketoacidosis? Ketones are continually produced in the liver, though at different rates depending on the level of dietary carbohydrates and proteins. Among individuals following diets high in carbohydrates, insulin levels are high enough to inhibit the breakdown of fat, and blood ketone concentrations are usually below 0.3 millimoles per liter. For those maintaining a well-formulated ketogenic diet, the usual ketone concentration is somewhere between 0.5 to 2 millimoles per liter. And such well-formulated ketogenic diets usually limit daily carbs to within 30 to 50 grams and proteins between 1.2 to 2 grams per kilogram body weight. Ketosis is a physiological state that is considered within normal. Although ketone bodies are acidic, in low levels of nutritional ketosis, the body's strict buffering mechanism can effectively deter the development of metabolic or anion gap acidosis. As Dr. Ben Bickman has said, the body defends its blood acid or alkaline levels so well, it takes a very significant amount of insult for it to go haywire. So you need not worry about developing ketoacidosis when you are just keeping yourself well within levels of nutritional ketosis. On the other hand, ketoacidosis occurs there is very high pathological levels of ketone bodies in the blood. And when does this happen? This may usually be encountered in patients with type 1 diabetes, where there is pathological absence of insulin production by the pancreas. And this is called diabetic ketoacidosis, or DKA. And this is especially in those not strictly compliant to insulin treatment, and which leads to very high levels of free fatty acids that are shunted over to the liver for ketogenesis or the production of ketones. Ketoacidosis may also occur in excessive alcohol binge consumption, and this is called alcoholic ketoacidosis. After ethanol is metabolized to acetic acid, this is then shunted to ketogenesis, especially when insulin level is low and glucagon level is high. This may occur when excessive intake of ethanol is coupled with decreased food consumption due to vomiting, thus leading to episodes of low blood glucose or hypoglycemia. As you probably have known by now, I advocate a very low carbohydrate ketogenic diet for the reversal of the so-called metabolic syndrome or insulin resistance. The so-called ketogenic diet, which as previously noted, maintains daily carbs of around 30 to 50 grams and 1.2 to 2 grams of protein per kilogram body weight, effectively limits the rise of the level of insulin in the bloodstream. Since insulin resistance is characterized by chronic elevations of serum insulin, or what is called hyperinsulinemia, the sustained decrease in blood insulin levels brought about by the ketogenic diet somehow gradually reverses the effects of the so-called insulin resistance syndrome or the metabolic syndrome. Now, how does this happen? Hyperinsulinemia, when it becomes chronic, eventually promotes the development of insulin resistance, thereby leading further to the manifestations of the metabolic syndrome. Various studies have shown that the pathology of chronic hyperinsulinemia is vascular in nature. Thus, hyperinsulinemia is itself the core of the development of atherosclerosis, lipogenesis, and its subsequent state of obesity, and the evolution of type 2 diabetes. I will be discussing this in more detail in another video. And since it looks like chronic hyperinsulinemia indeed seems to be at the bottom of it all, finding a means to effectively curtail the levels of insulin would then effectively work towards the reversal of metabolic syndrome itself. And that's where the role of low-carbohydrate diet regimens come into play. However, if you have any of the following medical conditions listed here, do be extra careful when trying to go on the ketogenic diet and discuss your options properly with a well-informed physician or medical professional. What are they? First, those with psychological eating disorders like anorexia or bulimia nervosa. Second, pregnant and breastfeeding women. Third, we have children and adolescents who are still in their growing up years, though I advocate having them eat whole, non-refined, and processed foods to make them avoid refined sugars and carbs, and to not just let them have high-carb snacks every so often, even if they're not really hungry. Fourth, those with severe diabetes, both types 1 and 2. More so in those with severe complications such as irreversible end organ damage in the kidneys. And fifth, those taking certain medications that may conflict with the state of nutritional ketosis, such as certain antipsychotics like quetiapine, risperidone, and aripiprazole, for they may increase insulin levels in some people, as well as certain anti-diabetic medications, which could result to severe episodes of hypoglycemia when taken together with a glucose-lowering ketogenic diet. Among patients with type 2 diabetes, this is where you need to partner with a well-informed medical professional to help you out with a medically guided therapeutic ketogenic dietary intervention, wherein your anti-hyperglycemic medications may gradually be decreased and perhaps even stopped or deprescribed if deemed appropriate depending on your compliance. When we know that obesity and type 2 diabetes are now established at epidemic proportions worldwide, and this is by all intents and purposes much related to the development of insulin resistance and its corresponding metabolic syndrome, I suppose at this point, we really need to redefine what is a healthy diet. Is it what government health authorities define as healthy based on guidelines they make and promote? Or is it that kind of diet that will truly optimize our body's metabolism and longevity? Lastly, some patients have asked me, what about intermittent fasting or IF? What is it? Can I combine it with my LCHF or keto diet? In a nutshell, intermittent fasting has its own good points with or without keto. But I guess that would take us much time here, and that would be worth a topic for another video, so watch out for it soon. So, I hope I got you the answers to all those questions brewing in your head about the ketogenic diet. Like this video and share it with your friends. Subscribe to my Low Carb Health Doctor channel. Hit that notification bell and see you in my next video. Thank you.